Good morning. Yesterday, we began a little bit of a review of those great words in Philippians 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So in these words, we have God's six-point strategy for mental peace. Rejoice in the Lord, number one. Be gentle to others, two. Three, remind yourself of the Lord's presence. Four, to cast out worry. Five, to pray with thanksgiving. And six, to focus your mind on those things that are excellent. So today, I want to spend a little time looking at step two. Be gentle to others. In the original Greek language, the word here translated gentleness, it's kind of hard to put that word into one English word. There's an element of selflessness in this word. A gentle person is one who does not insist on his or her rights or what is due him or her. A gentle person is big-hearted. A gentle person is willing to put others first, put their needs first, put their feelings first. First of all, is this not the spirit of our Savior? How gentle he was. In fact, in 2 Corinthians 10, we read, by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, I appeal to you. The Apostle Paul was talking about the gentleness of Christ. Persecuted, harassed, rejected, scorned, all of it innocently. Yet who has been more gentle than our Savior? We rejoice. Remember, we started by saying we rejoice. We rejoice. That is, we have an attitude to give God his due, to put God first in our lives, to seek his will. Right after that, then, we have we rejoice. That is, that we have an attitude that we give others what is due them, that we put them first. You know, what's interesting in this section is right before this, Paul had spoken to two ladies, two Christian women in the congregation. These Christian women were at a disagreement with each other. Paul simply says to them, agree in the Lord. And then right after that, he says, rejoice in the Lord. And then let your gentleness be evident to all. Joy. An attitude of the heart that seeks its character in the promises of Jesus, shows itself in how we treat others. There is no joy in selfishness. Joy involves an open heart, a generous love. Joy in the Lord tends to make us gentle and mild to others. Remember what our Lord said, by this all men shall know that you are my disciples if you love one another. When we seek to be self-centered, we suffocate the joy of the Lord in our hearts. But rather, when we remember the Lord's love and mercy, it instills Christian joy, the attitude of Christian joy. Too often, the world around us is characterized by those who seek their own rights and their own privileges. The shrill of selfishness is deafening. In fact, Jesus himself said that one of the characteristics of the world before he comes is the love of most will grow cold. Brothers and sisters, this is not to be you. When others demand their rights, believers will yield theirs. We make the interests of the weak and of the helpless our concern, and will gladly yield anything that does not violate our Christian principles. This morning, we're waking up to the news of what's happening in Minneapolis. But not just in Minneapolis, around the country, we hear the shrill of people in this whole coronavirus virus and the quarantine that's taking place, and we hear people demanding their rights. Don't get me wrong, I have nothing wrong with peaceful protests for the right reason. And many of the protests in Minneapolis probably are there for the right reason. But when it shifts over into selfishness, then we realize this is not joy in the Lord. This is not being gentle to others. Brothers and sisters, this can't be us. We can't be people who are always demanding our own rights. We have a responsibility, and that responsibility is to love, to be gentle to everyone that is around us. So let us remember that in this world that's so marked by conflict and struggle and selfishness, let us remember that God calls us to be gentle, to be big-hearted, to be open to others, continuing to love and put other people first in our lives. We need the Holy Spirit to strengthen us. And so this happens as we get into the Word. Now, brothers and sisters, whether at your family altar or around the church altar, we need to be in God's Word so the Holy Spirit can strengthen our hearts. And speaking of the Holy Spirit, this weekend we will celebrate Pentecost. If you wish to attend in-person worship service, remember to register at our website. The 8 a.m. service is almost full for Sunday morning, so please keep that in mind. There's still plenty of room at the 5 p.m., and there's still plenty of room at the 9:45 a.m. service. I'll talk more about our Sunday morning service tomorrow morning. I have one further request of you this morning. As you watch what's happening in Minneapolis, please pray for all people involved, both for both sides, and for wisdom to reign but also for peace to reign in their hearts. As I watched the videos this morning of the last night protests, it hits even more home to me on the one side, because my nephew and my godson works in as a Minneapolis police officer. And sitting there in that whole line of police officers together as they continue to back up from the crowd, thought to myself, when you realize that someone's life is in danger, let us pray that there's be peace on both sides, and that there can be people who work through the situation and bring about the right conclusion to what should really happen. But let's pray for our fellow citizens in the city of Minneapolis. So we go back into our readings today from the book of Acts, realizing we only have three more lessons left. I pray that God is leading you on this journey through this interesting book. So now let's get back to our readings, and God bless you on your readings, and God willing, we'll see you tomorrow.